Okay.
Good morning again. It is a good morning. It's the sun shining. Notices. Please make yourself aware of the CCBN news. It's getting a lot like War and Peace in its quantity. So there's a lot to take in. Far too much to tell you about. So please read and inwardly digest and mark and note what's applicable to you. It's 7 pages. So 6 o'clock tonight is the soaking service, which will be open to the first 30 odd people. So if you're after that, I'm sorry, but you'll be getting the bus home. But it will be on the Christchurch Network YouTube channel. Thank you, Mark. So, let's pray before we start. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your blessings that you pour down upon us, freely given and freely received. So be with us now, Lord, as we seek to give you your word. So thank you, Lord. Amen. So could we have our first song, please, Mark?
on his unchanging grace. In
stand before the throne.
We're going to pray together. We invite Jesus to come and be with us, be our guest and stay with us. So let's say together, come Lord Jesus, be our guest. Stay with us throughout this and every day. Come close to us that we may come close to you. Forgive us that we may forgive one another, and renew us so that where we have failed, we may begin again. Amen. Amen. We now invite David to read the Bible for us.
Right, this morning's reading is Matthew 18, 21 to 35. Jesus tells the parable of the unforgiving debtor. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to seven times. Jesus answered, I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had owed to repay the debt. The servant fell on his knees before him. Be patient with me, he begged, and I will pay back everything. The servant's master took pity on him, cancelled the debt, and let him go. But when the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. He grabbed him and began to choke him. Pay back what you owe me, he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, be patient with me, and I will pay back you, and I will pay you back. But he refused. He said, instead, he went off, had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, he said, I cancelled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you? In anger, his master turned him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all the owed. This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart.
Thank you, David. Over to you, Mr. Cox, to impart your words of wisdom.
It always helps if you unmute first, doesn't it? Yes, thank you. So, simply entitled Forgiveness. And this is such a big area, such a huge thing, isn't it? To forgive and to know forgiveness. Have you ever had to forgive somebody something? I would imagine we all have. And some things are easy to forgive, some things are hard, aren't they? But forgiveness is the core to all that we believe and we do. And this is an interesting story. I've told and used this story with children many a time. And as I was reading into it, it's interesting, really, because this whole idea of forgiveness in Jewish culture, it's one of those things that the disciples would have been aware of. So what you have to do in Jewish law was ask forgiveness for something for three times in front of witnesses, and that was enough. It was done. And so Peter was trying to be a bit clever, I think, here, because you know, seven's the perfect number, and he thought, do I do this seven times, not three, seven? How good I am in asking this, you know, I'm going to be better than the three times the law says. I'm going to ask seven times. And Jesus puts him down and says, no, it's 70 times seven. This is not literally. It's, no, you keep doing it. You keep forgiving. Why would you need to keep forgiving? Well, I would suggest that forgiveness, sometimes it takes longer than just once. Sometimes we need to have that act of forgiveness over and over again. Why? Because the enemy comes in and whispers in our ears. That thing that was done to you, that you need to forgive. A few days later, you find it's coming back into your head again. What was said, what was done, how much it hurt you. And you find yourself gritting your teeth. Well, I do anyway. And you feel angry again. You have all those emotions. And Jesus says, come on, let's get back to it. Let's forgive again. And as you forgive, it wears away the anger. It wears away the bitterness. A bit at a time. It chips a bit more off. It chips a bit more off until it becomes something that we can get rid of. We have to realize in a day of instants that sometimes some things aren't instant. They take time. Lord, I want it to go away. And God sometimes does. There are occasions where miraculously these things get taken away. But so often it's God wants us to persevere. How I hate that word. But it is a fruit of the Spirit. I have to persevere at things. I have to keep on at them. And you know, in that journey, what I find happens is I get rid of some of that baggage that I've got. And I walk closer with God. I'd rather not do that. But God takes me down that path. And he says, you're not alone, Steve. Let's walk it together. Let's get up in the mornings. And sometimes the first thing you have to do is to say, Lord, I'm going to forgive them again. Just help me not to hold on to that anger and that bitterness. You see, the imagery in this story is very, very strong. He was going to be sold into slavery, put into prison, had everything taken away. And we know the Bible says the wages of sin are death. It's a slavery. You sell yourself into slavery of sin in unforgiveness. And that's a really tough one. Because, you know, Lord, they hurt me. I've got every right to be angry. And Jesus says, well, have a look at my hands. Have a look at my feet. I've got every right to be angry, but I forgive you. And I'm starting from that very, very essence of Christianity, of our faith and our belief, is that Jesus died for our sins. And he did it willingly because he loves us. He doesn't want us to end up going to hell. He wants us to be with him in heaven. And he did that so we could have our sins forgiven. Now, on that sort of scale, I think I need to think seriously about forgiveness. I need to understand that I start my journey with Jesus, who forgives me and has forgiven me my sins. How much as far as from the east is from the west? You can never meet them up. That's a long way away. And that's what he wants for us. He wants us to know forgiveness. And part of that is being able to forgive. You see, what happens in unforgiveness is there are consequences. There are always consequences. You can't get away from this whole cycle that you go into. Unforgiveness will lead to bitterness, anger, all the things. If you read the fruits of the Spirit, all the opposites. And the enemy works his way in subtly, a little bit at a time. When I was a young lad, there was a fallout in church. And there was definitely unforgiveness. And I knew a friend of mine, I knew his mum, and she said to me once, She said, you know, I just can't sleep through the night anymore. I get so angry, I wake up, I have to do something. Just eating away at her, the bitterness inside. That's what the enemy wants, because unforgiveness puts a barrier between us and God. You cannot have both, I'm afraid. And yes, we start that journey, as I've said. Yes, you've got to own it and you've got to walk it. But God will do it with you. How do we break it? It's quite simple, really. It's by knowing Christ's forgiveness for us. And as I was preparing this, I realized that the essence to this, and probably an awful lot of what we do, is our walk with Christ. You see, ours isn't a faith that actually requires me to go and do X, Y, and Z to behave in that way and everything's all right. Our faith is a personal relationship with the living God. And if I don't have that relationship, then how can I walk with Him? If I don't draw close to Him, how can I expect Him to come and help me? And so a lot of this is, the question is, do you know Him? Do you know Him? Are you walking with Him? Because it's in knowing forgiveness that we can forgive. You see, the servant didn't appreciate the greatness of what he'd been forgiven. It was a huge sum, unpayable. He got himself into such debt, there was never a chance he could ever pay it back. And his master knew it. That's why he was going to cut his losses and sell them into slavery. Take everything he could, make something back. But he took it for granted. When he begged, he meant it. He was terrified of the consequences. But afterwards, it was almost like he walked out the door and went, got away with that one. There wasn't any understanding. There wasn't any gratitude of what he had been forgiven. Do we have that to Jesus? Do we have that gratitude, that love for him that says, thank you, Lord, for doing what you did? And I speak to myself. Or do I feel that's one I've got away with? You see, when he went to his fellow servant who owed him money, he put out of his mind what had happened to him. He was now back on top. Everything was all right. He was squared. He didn't owe anything. He could make some money back. He could make something out of this. So he wasn't prepared to forgive. But there are consequences to actions. And when his master found out, he had every right to reinstigate the punishment. Only this time it was far worse. This time it was prison and torture. Forgiveness must come from the heart. And that's that centre of us. That's that part of us that communes with God. That's that part of us that has that feelings, those empathies, all those things that allow us to open out to our Saviour. Because if it doesn't come from that, it's not going to work. I've had plenty of children who you said, now say sorry. And they go, sorry means nothing. Eh? It means nothing. You can't do that. We can't do that. It has to come from the heart. So I just thought about this, and I do realise that some of you are thinking, but you can't imagine, Steve, what I've been through. You don't know what I've got to forgive. I just can't do it. I can't do it. And you're right. I say again, you can't. And one of the things, we have such a self-sufficient society that it has to be on me to do it. And he says, no, you can't. It's grace. It's my grace that I'm going to give to you that allows you to forgive. What is grace? It's unmerited mercy or unmerited favour, it's described as. And it's God's desire to give it. We don't earn it. And if you call out and say, I cannot do this, God, I can't forgive, he'll say, that's right. I'm here. I can help. I can forgive. Look what I've done for you. Look at all the things you've done. I love you. Let's walk this together. Let's forgive together. And it's that relationship with him. I want to just really bring this to us as a church as well. And just to say, you know, I would say with great respect to all church people that often a church has not been good at forgiving and to demonstrate forgiveness. And we need to do that. We need to show forgiveness because that's how people are drawn to us. It's one of the ways they see a forgiving, a loving place. And that forgiveness that we do here shows people how much Jesus loves them, how much he forgives them. It's beholden on us to live a life of Christ. That's how we draw people to us. I saw many years ago in Leeds, reconciliation, act of forgiveness in church. And we all were really happy these two people had fallen out. And it lasted as long as the person sat down. I could hear her moaning about the person in front of me. And it was like, why? Why do it? That's not forgiveness. You have to do it from the heart and you have to mean it. People aren't fooled by us, you know. They see through us. It needs to be real. It needs to be absolutely, I've forgiven. Let's move on. Let's not drag it up again. Because that's what God has done for us through Jesus. And for us as a people, it is unity. This unity is largely based on unforgiveness. Not necessarily based on what we do to each other, because I'm going to get it wrong. I'm sorry to disappoint you, but I will get it wrong. And I will upset people. I will say things that are wrong. I'm sorry. But if we allow it to remain unforgiven, then we break the unity of the church. And unity is the forging of the love of Christ. And what's that based on? It's based on forgiveness. No forgiveness of sins, there's no salvation. No forgiveness in the body of Christ, there's no unity. And we need unity more than ever now to be the effective army that God calls us to be. We need to know forgiveness. We need to forgive. And we need to live in that forgiveness with each other. So I encourage you today, if God's prompted you, to say, you need to start that journey. Or maybe even you need to pick up that phone or write that letter, send that email. Then now's the time to do it. You won't always get the response you would like. But you have to start that. You are only responsible. I am only responsible for myself. I will answer for what I have done here. And one of those things is, are you holding unforgiveness? Maybe in other ways, you're thinking, well, why isn't this happening? Why am I not hearing from God? Well, God sometimes just says, look, you need to deal with that thing. You need to deal with that unforgiveness. So let's bring it to God. Let's not let it fester and grow. And let's persevere and join together in unity where we can make a difference as a body of Christ. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just thank you, Lord, that you loved each one of us so much that you sent your Son to die for us. Lord, that you forgive each and every one of our sins. Heavenly Father, help us to show that forgiveness to each other, to those around us, not to harbour bitterness or anger, but Lord Jesus, to seek you out, to help us to find true forgiveness from the heart. Lord, give us the grace, the mercy, and the love to do it so that we may be a unified body working for you, ready for you and what you have in store for us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Steve. So we're going to have our next worship song and then we're going to have a collect.
We say be still. Be still. So
the collect for today. God of constant mercy, who sent your Son to save us, remind us of your goodness. Increase your grace within us, that our thankfulness may grow. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. So we're going to have our DVD on giving, and then Elaine's going to lead us in our prayer.
I've lost the PowerPoint, hold on. I think I must have just closed it. Oh, there we go.
Over to you, Elaine.
I've had the words of Matt Redman going round and round in my head all morning. When all is stripped away, we simply come. So, Lord, as we pray this morning, we simply come to you, stripped. Almighty God and Father, you have called us into life to love and serve you. As we come before you today, help us to worship you with all our hearts, minds, strength, and gratitude for for your loving kindness. We praise you for your generous love to us, especially at this difficult time in all our lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the church around the world and at home, for leaders and all who strive to bring your love and teaching to their communities. May they increasingly be guided by your Holy Spirit to serve all God's people with love, truth, and humility. Increase our need to truly serve you in every way and to have compassion for the people who we serve. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We rejoice in your love and care for us at all time. We remember before you all who have faced trouble or disaster this week. We pray for the many parts of the world where there is conflict and violence and natural disasters. Especially today for all who have been affected by the fires in America. Lord, have mercy on the families affected. Point them to the people and authorities that can help them in their needs. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who face this time of change and uncertainty alone. Please be with them in their loneliness. In a time of silence, let's remember all those we know who need our prayers today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We especially pray for all those who are in hospital, who can't have visitors, for the people who are awaiting operations that keep getting postponed, and those with mental health issues and their carers. We ask your healing touch on all who are ill. Help them to rely on you more and more. We pray for those who have lost loved ones this year. Especially today, we pray for Pauline Rook's family. Lord God, compassionate and merciful Father, we ask that you would pour out your Spirit in this church today. We pray for your help in everything you have called us to do. May we know more of your grace and mercy and practice it ourselves towards the people we meet every day. Help us to serve one another, knowing that in our service we serve your Son. Merciful Father, accept these our prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Elaine. And we're now going to join together by saying the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Amen. So after we've shared the peace together, we're going to share in breaking bread together. So you'll need your bread and your juice. We are all one in Christ Jesus. We belong to him through faith. We're all heirs of the promise of the Spirit of peace. So may the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you, Lord.
With you.
And everybody else.
So peace be with you all. God bless. We're going to have another song and then we're going to share in breaking bread together.
Words have been echoed in what Steve said to us, as far as the east is from the west, so far has Jesus removed our sins from us. And that we do this in remembrance of what Jesus has done and of what Jesus is doing as he renews and forgives us every day. So I'm going to read from Matthew's Gospel, While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." Then he took the cup, gave thanks and offered it to them, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." So if you'd like to take in your hands, first of all, the bread. And before you actually eat it, it's so easy to just take this bread and eat it. Remember why we're doing it. We're doing it because Jesus' body was broken that we might be made whole. And so we eat the bread as we share this together. And as we take our cup, we're mindful that Jesus said his blood was poured out for everybody, and yet he invites us to drink and to share in this cup together. And so we share the wine, the promise of all that Jesus is. So we thank you, Father, for the gift of forgiveness, that you have forgiven all that we have ever done, and even what we might still do, in you we're made whole. So we thank you, Lord, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. So we're going to have our final song now, Everlasting God. Stay with us, Lord, throughout this and every day. Kindle our hearts on the way, that we may recognize you in the scriptures, in the breaking of bread, and in each other. For you live and guide us forever. Amen. So now may the grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the empowering of the Holy Spirit be with us all and those we love, today, tomorrow, and for all time. Amen. Amen. So thank you, Steve Cox. Thank you, David, for reading. Thank you, Elaine, for the prayers. And thank you, Mark, for the technology. So we'll hopefully see you all at 6 o'clock on the Sunday soak. Not in the bath, I hope, but clothed and fully dressed. So God bless and have a good day.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Thank you.